Hey guys, welcome back to my channel. So today's program is going to be a collective of several different and brand new movements that you will have not seen me do on the Workout Builder and probably not demonstrated ever on my social media history because I haven't done a lot of these. Part of that is just due to, you know, the gyms that I've been training at, they're kind of family style gyms and they don't have all of the fun like bodybuilder options. So the movements, and there are seven of them today, are not from one program. I've gone through my brand new Glutes and Shoulders program, part three, and kind of pulled out all the exercises that I just know you're gonna need some support with, particularly we've got like a mechanical drop set today. Y'all guys probably have no idea what that is unless you've done some other programs from other coaches that use these methods. But anyway, I'm not gonna talk too much about it right here, but I want you to make sure that you've got all of the information, why you're doing it, and hopefully give you something fun to look forwards to, because I know that's a big part of being motivated and enjoying your training program. Helps with your consistency. So let's hop in and get started. All right, you guys, so I'm probably gonna do about 2 minutes of warming up. You know the drill with my videos. Remembering we're really just trying to get some blood flow. We're trying to increase our core body temperature when we warm up. And also just get your muscle, primed and responding so that when we start to add load, we've got some good contraction, we've got some good neural connections. So again, as I'm going, I'm trying to lengthen that stride a little bit each time. All right, so I'm grabbing out my glute bands. I will have these available for you guys again soon on my website. It's just, I had to change, dispatch manufacturers as well. So these haven't been available for a long time because I'm just too busy with everything else. But I would like to be able to get them back up and for sale so that you guys can use them for, some of the more, warm-up type exercises. And then also for your glutes as kind of finishes, working in those higher rep ranges. Just with less loading to get in a little bit extra work that's not quite as neurologically taxing, these are not too bad. So I've got a nice wide band here. So this is the glute band 2 in pink and it's strength number 1. So it's my lighter band and it just allows you to get a little bit more range of motion when you're doing any of your abduction type exercises. I'm just gonna do 20 steps up and back, get my glutes firing up, because there is a little bit of glute work in today's program. These aren't bad to use either before you start squatting, just because it forces you to put pressure in your knee out. So anybody that struggles with knee vulgar when you squat, which is basically you might come down and you have a little bit of a knee cave, this is really good to practice that motion, but with a bit of resistance. So the first exercise that we've got today is a leg press, but it's not just gonna be any old leg press. So I wanted to incorporate some different training techniques. So this is called mechanical forced reps. So this is similar to a drop set, but the main difference is when you're performing a normal drop set, what happens is you continue to perform the same movement, but you're lightening the load to perform more reps and to elicit that fatigue state, or to increase the amount of stimulation and intensity of that workout. This is a little bit different. We're actually gonna keep the same load, but we're gonna transition, our position. So we're gonna start with a more challenging position. So I'm gonna do a quad focus leg press to begin with. And then once my quads are fatigued, I'm actually going to reposition my feet into, a high and wide position so that my glutes can then take over. So it's just allowing me to do a little bit more work without having to kind of change, the weight plates around. So if you're in a hurry and you don't have a lot of time, this might actually be a really good strategy to implement if you're wanting to achieve a really tough workout, but without a whole lot of time. So you notice I've got my feet low on the plates. I could make this even more quad focused by bringing my feet in together and turning my toes out a little bit. So when we get to our working weight, and I'm absolutely exhausted in that position, I'm going to take my feet up high. So basically no pause, and I'll come into that position instead. So something like this, because it's a compound movement, we're using multiple joints, it's a big heavy loaded exercise. You want to make sure that you are doing a number of warm-up sets. So I've obviously done some warming up here today, but I'm going to warm up on this machine as well. So I think three sets is probably adequate. I've just started with two plates. I'll work to three plates, and that would be my first working set. But I don't know how I'm going to go on the close stance, because that I'm a lot weaker in my quads than I am my glutes. I'm a lot more, I guess I lift from my posterior. And again, it's just because of how I'm put together, and my construct means that I'm a lot more posterior dominant in most of my exercises, including like a squat and deadlift. So I might not be able to do three plates on my quads. We'll see. By the way, Monster, you've done it again. This is their new strawberry dream flavor. You can't buy it in a 24 pack. We've established that. You can only buy it in a 12 pack. Nothing beats the sound of cracking your energy drink. I'd love to have a heart rate monitor on right now. Doof, 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 doof. That is some conditioning. Yikes. Alrighty, you've heard it first, it's hard. Now, I was at a gym last weekend, and their leg press did not have this nice big platform or plate for your feet. So in certain gyms, and depending on their equipment, you might not be able to do this exercise, or at least not the mechanical drop set, because there's nowhere to move your feet to. If that's the case, regular drop set's fine. Just take your load off. I usually recommend reducing the load by 15 to 20% for your drop set. So yeah, and it's just one. The most gangster watch. The new Apple Ultra for the Apple lovers. It's gigantic. All right. Guess what his password was? Okay,
wait,
one.
Wait till it gets a rest.
Okay. Yeah.
What the hell is going on?
Let's see. 142 at the moment. That's actually really, 156, there you go. 158. That's it, 158, that's my highest. The only thing that I actually get my heart rate up more is on the Stairmaster or spin class. Man, like, when I go really hard, you're like nudging 180. And then the fitter you get, and the longer you've been doing it, and how your body adapts to that training, and you go like twice as hard to kind of keep keeping that heart rate at the same place. Good, come on. Nine. Good work. Come on, one more. You got it, let's do it. One, rough it out. Two. Come on, don't stop. Three. Four. Come on, don't stop. Good. It's true, people. Women are better at endurance-based rep ranges. I said it's true, people. Women are better at endurance-based rep ranges. So I think the reason for that is, correct me if I'm wrong, this guy's our science, just a little bit. It's because women tend to have more estrogen receptors, I think, on their muscle cell. And I think that in turn increases nutrient delivery and elimination of
metabolic byproducts?
Yeah, that's the word. Thanks for finishing my sentence.
I think that makes sense. I don't know, I'd have a better explanation than that.
Yeah. And also I think the size of the muscle as well, and like blood occlusion.
Well,
I've heard of that. Hang on.
Continuous versus occluded blood flow?
Yeah.
That's tough. With higher mechanical loads, I think you get more mechanical squeezing.
Yeah.
Which might limit blood flow a little bit more.
Yeah.
I don't know if that would be a sex difference necessarily.
Hmm.
I think
it's probably relative, because I guess women naturally muscles are smaller, men naturally muscles are bigger. Yeah.
When some of it's equated for strength, you take a male female with the same strength.
Yeah.
Those differences are minimized. So some is, I think, this driven by absolute training loads.
Yeah. You heard it first, guys. All right, let's our leg press done. I would say that that was probably the one I was looking forward to the least. So, I haven't done my set yet. Shit. Why did you have to tell me that? Oh my word. Okay guys, now that I've finished my set, we have Smith machine, rear foot elevated split squat, or Bulgarian split squat Smith machine. I haven't done this in my entire life. It's a very common exercise, but it's not on the workout builder, and I've never done it. As always, there's always someone on the Smith machine, so we might scooch down to the next exercise. And I will come back to that. B stance, hip thrust. It too is being used. Okay, we've got an MC dumbbell lunge. MC Mark Carroll, buddy of mine from Australia. These are also torture. I haven't done these programmed in my workouts. I have done them before, but not in my training programs. So let's go and find some dumbbells. I guess these are also called a reverse lunge, but it's a single leg. So rather than doing like an alternating reverse lunge, we're gonna continue to work the same leg. And the leg that's doing the work is obviously the one that's on the ground. And we're going to hang on to something in front of us. So we're trying to get a nice wide stance. And that's going to increase the utilization of your glutes and a little bit more hamstring as well. Whereas if we were to do a shorter stride, you're going to be targeting your quad a little bit more. So see how I'm keeping my body position forward rather than kind of coming up straight like this. So the key difference there, if I keep my body upright, that is quad city. Quad city. Whereas if I go forwards and lengthen that stride, like that is absolutely more glute. So we're gonna do 3 sets, 12 per side. I'm gonna grab a heavier weight. So you can see Sam's actually lifting that leg at the back off and he's not letting it touch the ground. That is going to make it more challenging than if you come back to a complete rest or a stop. And remember, because you're in this bent over position, it's without putting your foot down, you're not really giving yourself any extra support. So it's going to keep the glute loaded a little bit longer than if you come back to a complete, stop and allow for some rest. I want to train my glute, my hamstring. I don't want to train my wrist today. I have no interest. So, gloves for this exercise. Remember, you are lunging on the opposite side that you're hanging on with. Okay, so wherever my hand is, dumbbells in the opposite, obviously, and you're lunging. Yeah. So whatever you're hanging onto, you want to have it like around your belly height. I noticed just hanging onto the top one, it meant that I was in too much of a stretch position with my arm. So hold on to something here. Good, Sam. Okay, I'll show you, the quad version this time. So notice that stride is a lot shorter and my body is completely upright. I've got a hair in my eyeball and this weight is way too light. 8, 9. Same again, probably a foot away for the upright, otherwise you can't hold on. Show me how to lie, you're getting better all the time and turning all against one is an art that's hard to teach. Another clever word sets off an unsuspecting herd, and as you step back in the line, a mob jumps to their feet. Now dance, fucker. So you still feel it in your glutes when you do the quad focus. It's just not as dramatic, and you certainly feel your quads fire up a whole lot more. So something to consider with anything that's like single arm, you probably can go heavier than you think. And the reason I say that is, imagine if you've got two dumbbells and you're doing like a regular static lunges, or you're doing a walking lunge. You are capable of doing 110 if you were using the 55s, right? So we're kind of halving that volume. We're also doing two legs individually as well, so you haven't quite got that same level of support. But don't be afraid to kind of pick a weight after you've done a few warm-up sets, of course. Going up from what you might normally grab when you're doing a two-arm dumbbell lunge or something like that. So I'm being a little bit naughty today. And for this last set, I hope that it's challenging enough. And remember, if you've gotten through, you know, you're at set number 3 and your program says do 12 reps. And you can tell when you get to that, you know, 10th rep that you've really made a poor decision on your weight selection, i.e. it's too easy. Rather than like stop your set, you know, realize that you're underloaded, just keep going until you get close to failure to save yourself some time. And remember, we know it doesn't matter what the rep range is, as long as you're getting close to, you're doing a good job. You should have great results. I lost my other wrap the other day. I'm now like on the lookout for everybody in the gym. I'm like, you only got my other wrap. It's probably laying in the car park somewhere. So I shouldn't blame anyone. Okay. So this program and all the programs that I'm going to be doing in the next 6 weeks is available on my website. So you don't even have to pay for it. I'm in the process of building my new app. Many of you probably already know the workout builder. I'm actually starting over again and doing it my way. So that's under development right now. I'm very excited. And I am very keen to bring a far more diverse range of programs, I guess features, AI learning, think that machine learning. So yeah, until that's built, I will be adding all of my new programs every month or every 6 weeks to my website so that we've all got something that we can kind of continue to work on, provided you have the same goals as me, which is gonna be glutes, lower body generally, like quads and hamstrings, and then shoulders. I have incorporated a few chest, back, buys and tries, and some core, but it's like one exercise for each muscle group, and really like that's what I'm doing is like my minimum viable volume on those muscle groups just to kind of maintain them. I really think that with all the loaded work I'm doing with my other compound exercises, so like RDLs or squats, whatever it is, just the amount of like, you know, scapular retraction and back musculature activation, I think it's still, it's helping me to maintain my body, my muscle mass. I'm honestly really surprised that I've been able to get away with such few upper body exercises, at least in my back, and not see substantial loss. About a year and a half ago, I actually stopped training altogether, and I was able to lose some muscle. So yeah, I think the message here is that once you've got that muscle, it's a lot harder to lose it, provided you do continue to stay consistent with some amount of training or resistance training. Okay, so I'm just thinking this through. I wanted this to be quad focused. So if you were looking here at this super machine, I'll turn around so you can see it better. It's got a nice angle, a lot of them do. I wish that more gyms just had the vertical Smith, because it makes it really difficult to know which way to face depending on the exercise. So when I come down, if you watch me side on under this machine, you're going to notice that my knee begins to travel forwards. So from here, so I'm like coming down and forwards because of this angle, whereas if I was to face the other way, use my other leg, then you can see. Yeah. Now I'm going to be coming back. So you can see my knee doesn't achieve the same forward angle. So this is the way I want to do it for today, but for you, at any point, if you do want to do more of a, again, glute focused, and you've got one of these annoying ass angles, now you know which way to face. If you're doing this with body weight or dumbbells, I would always recommend just doing a set of say 5 to 8, just body weight, and take it all the way down to the bottom. Don't plonk yourself down, like protect your knee, just to practice that range of motion. And it'll also help you get, I guess, focused for when you add load, so that you're not completely off balance and caught off guard. So, okay, I'm gonna be extra conservative. I'm gonna put 10s on I usually do the 45s for regular reverse lunges without the foot elevated. Remember, when you're doing a reverse lunge, you've still got that support from the back leg to drive up. When we're doing that Bulgarian, there's no support from that back leg, so this is a harder exercise. So don't be fooled and think that you can lift the same. And if you can, I'm very impressed. So one of the things I'm really focusing on trying to do here is keep my hips square in the mirror. So you may find, if you do have a little bit of an imbalance, that your hips shift to one side. So if you've got a mirror in front of you, it can be helpful to kind of just glance forwards and make sure that you're pushing straight through and not shifting. Because the last thing you want to do is start adding load and you're not correctly or lifting with good correct form. Take a look at his back foot. So it's kind of kinked in like this. So I would like for you guys as well to try and straighten that back foot up as much as you can so that your hips do not rotate when you come down and try to drive through. So what will happen is some people, they're either really tight through their ankle musculature, maybe their calf is kind of limiting that mobility or that range of motion, but it usually travels all the way up and we start to see misalignment at the hips, or it's starting at the knees up to the hips. And if you continue to add load with a poor technique starting on the ground up, we start to risk overdeveloping the wrong or developing imbalances left to right. So hip square. I'm probably going to do the same thing now that I've pointed out that. Crush these last three reps. I can definitely feel my body wanting to shift to the side. It takes so much focus to keep square to that mirror. So I'm just giving a little bit of redirection for that back heel. So for Sam, and this is not an uncommon thing for a lot of people, guys, they get a little bit of internal rotation with their toe. So I'm just putting the slightest bit of pressure on his heel there to keep things square. Better. Good. Trying to keep everything square. My quads feel like they're gonna pop off. Oh my goodness. Okay, heart rate 165.
Am I here on 70?
166. I reckon that's it. 168. Someone call 911. 169. 170. Why is it going out? I feel like these are so delayed. So Sam is a professor at USF and does a lot of research and likes data, likes numbers. So does that mean that you really like this watch?
Oh yeah, it tracks everything. So I check my lifting, my running, and my walks.
Yep.
So, yeah, I'm going to see at the end of the year how much I do during that.
You even use the activity, so I think most of you probably have apples. If you don't, they're really good. I think just to keep you accountable, without having to like go to a motivational book or a phrase or something, like you've got it on your watch and it gives you notifications to stand, or it shows you and displays your movement for the day. You can set your movement targets. So if you're competitive at all, you look down and you're like, oh, still got 2,000 steps I got to do today. You just start jogging on the spot.
I think a lot of people find that you may work out for an hour and a half, but you're still sedentary because you sit at work all day. So I sit at a computer all day. So if I'm not intentional about going on a walk, I'm a sedentary person, even though I work out.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I'm the same.
And that's much worse, I think, for long-term health outcomes than not meeting this stuff.
Yeah, absolutely. What do you think your steps were like prior to actually having like knowledge of what you should be getting to, and then having to do intentional walking?
Yeah, probably 6,000 or 7,000.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So for the reference, mine's like 3, because I don't move.
But on a lecture day, it'll be 3,000 or 4,000.
Yeah. Yeah. There you go. Yeah.
Sit, prepare for lecture. So mm-hmm. You're sedentary.
And I think it also goes to show like there's so many folks that they will do that comparison game, and it's not a place that you want to be, but it still happens. And some folks are like, well, you know, why do I have to do an hour of cardio every day, you know, but why does this person look this way? And they don't have to do any of that. And the reality is they probably just move a lot more with their occupation. Maybe they've got kids and they're running them around to school in the mornings. They've got after school activities. Maybe they do their own workout. So it's really hard to kind of compare. Like I will often get asked, well, how much cardio do you do? How much resistance training do you do? And you really need to like think about your lifestyle and what you can actually manage, and be realistic about it. Because I used to think that, you know, I should be able to eat 2,500 calories every day and just lift. But I also know that's totally not realistic for me anymore, because I just can't move as much as somebody else. I'm in front of my computer for 9 to 10 hours a day. So the only exercise and movement where I'm expending calories is what I intentionally do here in the gym. And lifting, you know, for me, I don't think that it's the most effective way if I'm just focusing exclusively on burning calories. But the benefits are, it is burning some calories, but it's also training in a way that's going to help maximize retention of your muscle if you're dieting, or it's obviously going to be supportive for your muscle building goals. And then I have to walk if I want to get any other movement in. And that does increase my energy expenditure by, you know, probably a couple hundred every day. And that's the extra couple of hundred calories that allows me to have, I know, something else fun every day. So it's worth it to me to do a little bit more planned movement, even if it's late at night or early in the morning, because it permits me a bit more flexibility to eat things that I enjoy better. So, you know, you have to kind of weigh up the pros and the cons, and it's not always realistic to want to get to this amount of, you know, caloric intake if you just don't move. So notice Sam's back foot has improved quite a bit just since that first set. So he's keeping it a lot straighter. His hips are traveling square to that mirror, and he's got less movement at his knee now. So it's probably a lot harder for him right now. His quad's doing a lot more work than it was before, because that's basically a compensatory mechanism. Your body is trying to compensate. So it's obviously, there's a little bit of a weakness on one side for him, probably glute. And that's why you're getting that toe in. Hey. Yeah, that's better. Good. Yep. So the other thing that may actually be occurring, I'm just looking at his posture from a postural standpoint, maybe some hip flexor tightness, or tightness through his quadricep. So he's not able to get that full range of motion unless he kind of compensates by giving himself more range by turning in the toe. So that's also potentially what was going on there, because I can feel that in my hip flexors and my quads too, just a little bit. Okay, last one. I'm really trying to push hard through the center of my foot. So also on the program that you can download on the website, any exercises that I still think you guys might not know how to do correctly, I've attached a link. Now these links aren't me because I haven't filmed those demonstrations. I've probably done 400 exercises over my career, but I haven't been able to keep up on top of the last few for obvious reasons. Sorry. They're links of random folks, but they do have good form. So there are those exercise demonstrations on that program. So I can't tell you the last time I've trained at a gym at this time of the day. It's so nice. So nice. We did have to wait for the Smith, though. So. I just spoke too soon. It's just like there's probably a third of the number of people that are in here right now compared to usual. I haven't taken a look at their barbell selection yet, so I'm gonna go on a walk. You guys can come with me, because I'm looking for a short barbell as opposed to your normal regular 45 pound. These are usually 20 pounds, 20 to 25, and they're perfect for a B stance. The reason that we wanna have these shorter barbells is it kind of keeps the weight centered where you've got the most control. If we've got a really long barbell or a regular standard barbell and you're trying to do a staggered stance, think about, what's the word that I'm looking for? I am definitely not a maths expert, but think about like when you've got weights out here and how long you can hold them for versus weights in here. You can hold them for a lot longer when they're in nice and close to you because of your center of gravity. So when we're doing these V-stance hip thrusts, we're already a little bit off center. So if you get off balance and you've got a long regular barbell, you go all over the place. So that's why we use a shorter one. Keep it nice and tight. Yes, we have one. You may recognize the logos on here because this is Brett's product. He and I are neighbors. Sorry, that's kind of funny. When I bought a place here, one day he just comes up in the gym and I'm like, what are you doing here? Don't you live in Vegas? He's like, no, I just bought a house. I'm like, oh, me too. So yeah, we were actually meant to train at his gym today, and he sent me like a great video tutorial, how to get in, where the lights are. I'm like, yo, I need the address. So I've been there once before, but I didn't take note of the address. I guess I just punched it into my navigator. So yeah, I'm not there today. I really wanted to train, so hopefully we can tomorrow because it's set up really nicely. Okay, so B stance. We are going to position our foot close to the bum, probably half a foot. And then the other one, I'm gonna say you probably want your back heel halfway up the length of your foot, like so. So you're gonna keep that toe up on the way down. And again, you can adjust where you want to put your foot, but the further out you go out here, the more of your hamstring you're gonna use. I'm not really here to train my hamstring, so I wanna pull it back, at least not today, a little bit. All right. my model is going to step in and I'm going to teach him how to do this. This is good. I don't think he's ever done this before, so it's going to come down to how good of an instructor I am. First off, we need some collars. That was silly. Please make sure you use collars for this because you're not going to be coming up center because both feet aren't flat on the ground. So your barbell is going to shift a little bit. So you do want to make sure that they are securely fastened. Okay, so dudes generally have longer legs. They always complain about getting into a hip thrust. So Sam, you want to stagger your stance and bring one of those feet a little bit closer. And now I want you to turn your toes out. Make sure that your feet are hip width apart. Yep. And then you want to bring that toe up at the front. Yep. Good. Tuck that chin. Two more. One more. All right, switch sides. Okay, make sure that your feet are positioned in center. Yep. Turn that toe out. Good. One. Two. So we're going to isolate a little bit more the leg that's in closest to you. So 2 feet, obviously you're getting even tension. This is isolating the leg that is closest to you. So the one that's up is like the supporting, it's not doing much of the work. So if you do have a little bit of an imbalance from your left to right side, this would be a great exercise to incorporate. You can probably tell that, again, if you're working with a physical therapist, they probably have been able to show you some of your hip shift, knee valgus when you're squatting, or any other kind of like technical things that you're doing incorrectly that might be due to some of these imbalances. So I will often just program like single leg extension, single hamstring curl, B stance squat, B stance RDLs, just to make sure, and I'll do the others as well, but it kind of helps prevent me from getting too far in the wrong direction if I'm just always doing your two leg, two arm type movements. So again, just to remind you, when you come up into that extension, you want to make sure that the foot that's on the ground, when you're in extension, is at a 95 degree angle. If you're coming up into extension and you've got, I don't know, something that's more open, I don't know, 105, 125 degree angle, your foot's out too far from your body. So you want to bring it back in. So I think one of the benefits of filming your workouts, like I get really annoyed having my camera set up all the time to try and film my training, but not only is it, you know, it's good to be able to help you guys, but it also helps me check my own technique. Like even the best of us mess things up royal every now and then. You need to recalibrate. So my stand is like $10 on Amazon and it's great. Okay, here we go. So hopefully I've got a right 95 degree angle there. So it's a little bit light. I'll probably go up my next set. Yep, all the way up though. Yep, 7, 8, let's go to 15, 9, if you can, 10, 11, 12, 2 more, and rest. So if I was Sam, I'm not going to tell him this, but he probably should rest between sets because he's not going to get 15. 6, 7, 8, 9. Sit that rest. What did I tell you guys? I'm actually going to take the weight up because that was challenging for 15, but my program doesn't say 15, it says 10. Typically I try to program lower reps for single arm or single leg movements just because they take forever. I don't have time for that. So if you have trouble getting in, I just usually like force my feet into the place that I want them to go. I do the same on like any leg exercise. All right, that first one's going to be the hardest to come up and the rest should be easier. Here we go. So notice I'm only doing a 3-quarter rep here. I'm kind of keeping it isolated to that top 3 quarters. Probably could go on. I'm going to rest. Okay. Second leg is so much harder. So that first set that you did on your left leg, you got 15 reps. And then didn't rest, and then you performed 9. Some people in our industry would tell you that you need to wait 5 minutes between sets. What are the downsides of waiting? What are the upsides of waiting? Or is there no difference?
Longer. You're going to recover a little bit more and your volume will be higher on your subsequent sets. I think it only matters if you compromise your volume below a certain number of reps. So if I only got 3 reps because I didn't rest long enough,
yeah,
then I sacrificed, I think, the ability to get everything out of that next set. But if I get 15 reps and 10 reps and 8 reps, I think that'd be the same as doing 3 sets of 15 with longer rest periods.
Yep.
And it's just about fatiguing your muscle, activating your muscle. And the first set you do, you activate a large amount of the muscle fibers.
Mm-hmm.
The second set, some of them are already fatigued, so mm-hmm. you have to turn on other fibers.
Mm-hmm.
By your third set, you've probably activated the majority of the fibers in the movement
mm-hmm.
Enough times to tell those fibers to grow. So I don't think resting more is actually just going to make that process take a little bit longer.
Yeah.
That makes sense.
Yeah. Now what about, so today we're doing a single leg exercise compared to 2 legs. So in this case, you're potentially sacrificing one side, side's potential than the other. I can see how that argument would work if you're doing like 2 legs at the same time, where if you don't rest and you go again and you only get a few reps.
Yeah.
That makes sense to me. But what about single leg? Or single arm.
So are you talking about the fact that the second leg is fatigued?
Yeah. So
it's less than ideal?
Yes.
I think if you cared about absolute strength, then it wouldn't be ideal.
Mm-hmm.
Like strength development might be compromised in the limb that goes second.
Mm-hmm.
But
hypertrophy?
But growth, I think, would be the same.
Yep.
So the smartest thing to do would just alternate which leg starts first.
There you go. There's a reason why we start with different feet first, guys. And different arms. Good feeling when you finish your last set. So I was training one of my clients the other day in Miami, and I guess he isn't consistently doing pull-ups. So I just assume that, like, when you've been an elite professional in sport, that you probably still have some athleticism. So you were doing pull-ups, and so I did my set. He's like, "Can I get a spot?" I'm like, "You don't need a spot." So I was like, "You know what? I got something." So I go, this is a man, by the way, who's in his late 40s. We're talking like pro baseball. So I go to my bag and I pull out my pink band. And I walk over, I'm like, "Alex, there's a reason this is pink." I'm like, "It's because I know that you don't want to use a pink girl band to do pull-ups. So this is your motivation to continue practicing pull-ups so that we don't have to use this." It's quite funny. I don't think many men want to feel emasculated. That's the thing. I think we were talking about this recently, like just the concept of a hip thrust. I think a lot of men are really scared to do it. Like, what's your opinion, Sam?
I'm not a huge fan. I mean,
you've never done it before, right?
I've never done it before.
Yeah.
I think men in general maybe care less about their glutes.
Yeah.
And then just the movement.
Well, the girls don't care about their glutes. Let me say that again. Well, the girls care about their glutes. Yeah, I think we need to overcome this stigma. Yeah.
I'm working on it.
All right, girls, if you've got a husband or a boyfriend or a friend that you're bringing along to the gym, get them so out of their comfort zone and teach them hip thrusts, and then just remind them how much you love their ass. Okay, so we do have one more lower body exercise. Now, in an ideal world, I probably would have programmed, let's be clear, this isn't a single program from my new workout. I've gone through and taken some of the exercises that I think you guys would like to see tutorial on, or more instruction, or just like you've never seen it done before, and the tutorial and demonstration is beneficial. So this is like a mixture. But if this was a workout, I would probably put the two upper body exercises that I've got here as well in the center. So I do lower because that's my primary focus. But then after like exercise 3 or 4 of lower body, you can tell you're starting to, you know, tire and fatigue. So to give your lower body a little bit of a break, I would probably schedule or program the two upper body in between and come back and finish off with those last two exercises. Anyway, we haven't done it that way today. Up next, the machine is taken, so we'll come back to that. Myo reps. You guys have probably done myo rep sets on a bunch of exercises in previous programs, so I guess this is just a different training technique that allows you to get through, number one, your workout a little bit quicker if you don't have a whole lot of time. So we're working, set number one, we do 15 reps. And you're going to do that with a weight that you can lift pretty comfortably at a, you know, rate of perceived exertion, probably like a 7 or an 8. So something that you can do that's not failure. We're going to pause for 10 seconds, and then we're going to repeat another 6 to 8 reps. And that is what we call the myo rep set. Pause again for 10 seconds, and then you're going to repeat another 6 to 8 reps. And you do that, we'll continue that process for as many myo rep sets as you can, before you get to the point at which you can no longer perform 6 to 8 reps with good technique. So I guess this is kind of working on the principle of, Sam, what's this word that I'm looking for? Effective rep range. So think about doing, what's the best way to describe this? If you do 3 sets of like 15 and you pick a certain weight, the first 10 reps or so might be fairly comfortable, but the last 5 might be really difficult. So we're kind of not allowing yourself enough rest so that all of those consequent or subsequent sets are challenging. So it's in an effective rep range. Sam, do you want to throw some science in there?
it's kind of like skipping to the end of the set. So
yeah,
when you do a set of 12, you get that burning sensation, let's say the last 5 reps. So with this, you take 10 seconds recovery. Mm-hmm. In that previous set, you should feel burning, you should feel fatigue. Mm-hmm. And if you rested for a long time, that would go away. Mm-hmm. With this technique, you take advantage of some of that fatigue still being present. Mm-hmm. And I would say instead of starting on rep 1, it's kind of like starting on rep number 7.
Mm-hmm.
Just kind of start a little farther ahead in your set by taking advantage of the fatigue that was already present.
Yeah, so we're manipulating time to, I guess, work in that more effective rep zone. So unlike, I guess, strength-based training where we're working 1 to 6 reps and we're using heavy loads to elicit, you know, the anabolic signaling, this is working probably more in line with like your endurance rep ranges. So we're not using heavy loads, we're using a lighter load, but for more reps to accumulate some of those metabolic byproducts as another way of eliciting anabolic signaling. So it just helps you get through the set faster if you're in a hurry. So I will often do this. Calves is a great one. At the end of my session, I'm always looking at the clock going, man, I don't have 3 sets or time to do 3 or 4 sets. So I'll just do a myo rep set. And then I've probably achieved a similar, I guess, stimulation than I would have if I did 3 or 4 sets of 15. Because I actually haven't done this exercise yet with the myo rep set. So I'm just gonna warm up the old shoulders. Also, one of the new things that we're doing on my new training platform is having an entire section dedicated to rehabilitation, to mobility, to dynamic stretching, to static stretching, so that you can warm up effectively. You can rehab your own injuries. Now that we have our chiropractor, physical therapist on board, on Team Holly, which is getting rebranded, so it's not going to be Team Holly soon, but we're going to have all those things. So if you're somebody that struggles with like shoulder pain, we've got a badass team of ladies that are putting together some really cool stuff. So stay tuned. Glad I used this way. Oh, okay, 10 seconds. I don't know why I program these things. All right, 6 to 8. Yep. Oh. Nasty person this was that wrote this poem. What's up, guys? That's 3. Do my reps up. I got one more. I think I got one more. That's it, folks. You didn't misread the set number. It is one set. That's a set. Now, historically, I have absolutely programmed you to, if I'm feeling really mean, 3 Maya rep sets. I know that I've done that on leg extensions. And I think part of that was, it's just another way to get more quad volume without, I don't know, having to doing 15 more exercises in a session. But it is really tough, so that's it for the shoulder component of that exercise. Now Sam's turn to suffer. This is a good spot for your first set, guys. If you do, it's too heavy. Three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine. All right, there's my rip set. Let's do it. 6 to 8, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, good. 7, last one, drop those weights. So just while Sam's resting, 3, 4, you can either spot from the elbows. Most people prefer elbows. You can also grab the wrists. If somebody, you can tell they've got a little bit of a weak wrists. Sam prefers elbow, I'm pretty sure. Off we go.
Yeah.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, good. 6, nice. All right. While he's doing that, you guys want to come with me. We're going to finish off our lower body exercises, at least for this program. I'm doing a high box step up today, so a lot of glute stuff. Now, I probably wouldn't normally put this many glute specific exercises in one program, but again, this is for demonstration purposes only. But you can obviously use these however you like. I need to find a high box though. All right, so this box is probably a fraction short for high box. That's all we've got. So just looking at the angle here of my knee, it's probably 95 degrees. If you truly want to get maximum glute, focus and isolation, you want to be a little bit higher than that 95 degrees. So this is where I'm at today, but we're going to be doing dumbbells. And the whole goal here is to not allow that back leg to rest on the ground. And notice again, similar to what I was doing before with the lunge, I'm going to try and keep my body in that forward lean to keep my glute lengthened. So it's constantly getting worked. Sam's behind you guys right now, just rolling his eyes and laughing. It's like my poor bum. So this back foot is really not doing a whole lot. So I've got my hand on the wall and that leg is doing most of the work. So when you swap sides, you probably want to shuffle the box over, because when you're in that forward position, your head should be past the wall. So you want to have space for you to get into that forward position. So leaning forwards, keeping that leaning forwards position, coming out and lightly tapping. Now even my hand here is barely touching. So see how you can see my hip pushing out? That's me not being as strong in this position. So that's really hard to stay square. And I'm trying to keep my knee from wobbling all over the place. So to begin with, if you don't have a lot of stability, use the wall, that's what it's here for. As you get stronger, you want to try and be able to do this set without holding on. Good. So notice how his back foot is kind of coming down onto the ground. He's using a little bit more support on that side. So that to me would indicate that he's probably not as strong on his right. And that probably makes sense, because I'm pretty sure Sam is left-handed. So he's probably more dominant on the left side. How's that? Does that side feel more challenging for you?
Yeah.
There you go. All right, I'm going to try this with a little weight and see how I go. When you're doing step-ups, you may have done a weighted step-up version or a weighted high box step-up. Because we are isolating the glute and I want you to really keep that forward position, I don't want you to end up loading your quad more than you need to. You won't be able to lift as much as what you might normally do for a regular weighted step up, okay? Hence why I've only got these. Normally I would use probably 35s for step ups where I'm coming all the way up, but this is so much harder. Okay, let's see how we go. Woo. Feel my knee. 11, 12. All right, I can go up. But I can feel my knee shifting a little bit. So that's what I'm going to try and work on for the next few weeks of this program. Hopefully I can get to the point where it's really stable and I've strengthened some of those supporting ligaments. Yep, so Sam just asked a good question. Is the weight, do you carry the weight the same side as the foot that's on the box? Yes. Good, try to minimize the amount of support on that wall if you can. That's better. So you can see when he comes down now, much less support on that back foot compared to the side that you just saw, indicating he's probably got stronger left glute and quad than he is right side. Okay, focus on square hips. That's better. So by his second set, you can already see that form correction. Now he's actually concentrating on really pushing through that heel, keeping his hips square and body forwards. And also, once you get strong enough, you may like to, because this is a higher rep, use your versa grips so that you can focus on your glute and not your grip strength. And practicing what we preach, start with the opposite leg. Be prepared for toasty glutes the next few days. Really toasty. Spin myself around. Okay, guys, so the next exercise is a rear delt exercise. So I can't take all the credit for this. This is actually one of my coaches and best friend, Shelley Beatty. She was here visiting me a few months ago and was like, oh, I've been wanting to try this exercise. Can we do this instead of something else? I'm like, okay. Show me something that I don't know. And she showed me something I didn't know. So most of the rear delt exercises that I've done traditionally are either vertical or I guess horizontal prone position. So this is unique in the sense that you're going to be supinated. So you're going to be laying on your back. And I guess first off, your position of your bench needs to be smack bang in the center of where your cables are coming from. So I really like this setup. There are several different kind of, cables that have these moving moment arms. So basically you want to have the width of the cable on a position. So if I'm going to move this around, so obviously these move. Put it at a place where it's probably half a foot wider than your actual arm span. So it may need moving around and adjusting if you're working out with somebody else, just so that it fits your anatomy. So for me, I've got this set on 8. Make sure they're the same. And then as far as height, you actually need to set them one higher than the other. I'm just using the letters here to kind of guide that. So this one's on I and this one is on J. So a little bit of stuffing around, and then also you've got to get used to your weights. I'm training at different gyms all the time, so I just feel like I'm forever fluffing around with weight settings, but this is kind of heavy, so I'm actually taking out the pins altogether. And I'm just using their fractionals. So I started my warm-up set with 5, and I think now for my first working set of 12 to 15, I'll probably, hope I'm not overloading, I've done this miscalculation many times. I've got 10 on there now, so we'll see how we go. The hand that's going on top is from the high pulley. And now that's better. So you're gonna keep your chest up, and you're just bringing those cables out nice and wide, keeping your shoulder blades depressed or retracted, and I'm going to go just to the center here or until I feel like there's no more tension at the bottom. 13. Ooh. Ooh, yeah. I really, really like this exercise too. This program's got all my favorites. Okay, keep your head back on the, yeah. Chest out, shoulders suppressed, lights down, yeah, exactly. So see how he just kind of lifted his chest up?
That is him pulling back
his shoulder blades. Good. So this could be a warm-up set for Sam. Once he's done 5 or 8, he can stop. Yep. And remember to be gentle with equipment. As a former gym owner, I'm in the gym all the time, and it ekes me when I see people dropping weights from standing or letting the weight plates crash down. It's just, number one, it's so loud and annoying. It hurts everybody's ears. 2, no one's looking at you. Sorry. I think I'm going to say anyone that has an ego. Again, I'm probably stereotyping. It's just unnecessary. You don't need to smash your weights down. But moreover, these things cost so much to fix and repair. Just to have a maintenance person come out and repair one machine, just a call-out fee is probably close to $500, not to mention the, you know, labour parts and things that need to be replaced on some of these. So I'm so glad that Sam gently put down that cable. So really thinking about keeping my chest up. keeping constant tension by keeping my arms long.
And then on the contraction,
that's the concentric phase, I'm going to exhale. Feels good actually. So hand on hip. I've never done this before. I'm just assuming that it feels great. Oh yeah, that's great. So chest up, let it come across the body, keep that arm straight. And I probably could have kept two on. So there you go. Add that to your exercise library. Guys, that's it. That's it today. So I really hope that you enjoyed the new exercises. For those of you that are in week one, because I am starting this week as well with you guys, it's been a whole lot of fun. So if any of you have questions, please come to this video and comment if there's something else in the program that you're not sure about, or if you aren't following me on Instagram, I'm sure many of you are, just make sure that you pop over, send me a DM or get in touch with me somehow. There's places that you can do that, like my email. but I will absolutely record other movements if you're wanting some more training cues or tips for how to perform these correctly. So that's it, guys. I hope that you have a wonderful, wonderful weekend. Make sure that you're subscribed to my channel. Give this a like, share it with your friends if you found it helpful, and I'll see you next time.